shine, sand and sea. But there's far more to the Caribbean. It has a hidden, wild side. From the islands of the Caribbean Sea to the shores of Central America, this is a region of incredible variety. With lush tropical rainforest, salty lagoons, windswept deserts, and volcanic peaks. Home to exotic wildlife, a world away from the Caribbean we think we know. Both on land and beneath its warm, clear waters, it usually appears serene. But the Caribbean and its wildlife have been shaped by cataclysmic forces. Heaven can turn to hell. This journey through its many islands reveals why the Caribbean is such a treasure trove of life. On the northern fringes of the Caribbean, stretching out into the Atlantic, are 700 low-lying islands sitting on a vast limestone shelf known as the Bahama Banks. The Bahamas were named by the Spanish. Baja Mar means shallow sea. These waters offer good visibility and protection from danger, ideal for some of the Caribbean's most intelligent animals. Spotted dolphins. They cruise the banks in family groups, keeping in touch with a wide range of whistles and squawks. The baby of this group is around 3 months old. He's not yet got his spots. He'll shadow his mother for his first 3 years, learning the ins and outs of dolphin life. For now, she reassures him with constant caresses from her fin. Within the group, this kind of body language helps to reinforce relationships and keep the peace. But there's trouble in paradise. Large bottlenose dolphins also live here. Male bottlenose are much more aggressive than their spotted neighbors, charging and biting rivals. Although the different species often socialize, sometimes the bottlenose throw their weight around. Bullying often has a sexual edge. Male bottlenose try to mate with spotted females and harass young males. But spotted join forces to ward them off, often calling on neighboring groups to help. Thank you. bully tries to stand his ground, but outnumbered, he soon turns tail. While spotted dolphins leave the banks to feed in deeper water, bottlenose fish the shallows. These empty shallows may not seem a hunter's paradise, but you just need the right detection kit. A dolphin uses echolocation to see through the sand. He produces between 20 and 1,000 clicks a second, speeding up as he homes in on hidden prey. Once he pinpoints buried treasure, all he has to do is dig it out. Using his body weight, he nosedives up to a meter beneath the sand. Until he finally pulls out his prize, a razor fish. These shallow sandbanks are just one of the Caribbean's many landscapes. To the southeast of the Bahamas, there's another. A chain of islands marking the far eastern boundary of the Caribbean Sea. At their outer limit, jutting into the Atlantic, lies Barbuda. Like the Bahamas, Barbuda is flat and famous for its endless sandy shores. Step back from the beach, and there's another, very different world. A vast, shallow lagoon, dotted with mangrove trees. Remote, secluded, and a stone's throw from rich Atlantic fishing grounds, it attracts one of the world's most charismatic birds. At around 4,000 pairs, this is the Caribbean's largest colony of magnificent frigate birds. Each year from August to October, males fly in from other corners of the Caribbean to breed. Once a male arrives, he's got his work cut out to find a mate. First, he inflates a pouch to try to stand out from the crowd. Has to jostle for a good nest site, high in the mangroves, then fight off rival males to keep it. All this aggression can be seriously deflating. Once he's seen off the competition, he still has to lure a mate. He drums up interest from a browsing female, and she comes in for a closer look. It's hard to say exactly what a female looks for in a partner, but a good nest site is crucial. This one isn't up to scratch. Plenty more birds in the sky. The females look for a location with clear access, where the wind can lift them on and off the nest. And this one seems ideal. But before the pair can raise a family, they have to build a nest. And for that, they need plenty of the frigate's most valuable currency. Sticks. Loose sticks can be hard to find and easy to lose. Is ambushed by his fellow frigates, the true pirates of the Caribbean. These high-speed aerial acrobats are experts at mid-air theft. All his flying skills to hang on to his stick so he can build a nest. And there's another threat on the horizon. One that may ground even the most high-flying male. June and November, hurricanes can strike out of the blue. Frigates often ride out stormy weather in the air, but these males need to hang on to their nests. Exposed, they're in the firing line of winds that could reach 150 miles per hour. Hurricane Louis hit Barbuda and wiped out an entire generation of frigate birds. Luckily, this one's just a squall. Hurricanes are just one force of nature the Caribbean has to face. Another force created some of the Caribbean's most beautiful islands. Barbuda is part of a chain called the Leeward and Windward Islands, running down the eastern boundary of the Caribbean Sea. But other islands in the chain are quite different. Instead of flat shorelines, they have towering peaks, all formed from volcanoes. The Pitons of St. Lucia are the cores of dormant volcanoes, which erupted more than 20,000 years ago. The slopes of these volcanic islands are cloaked in thick forest. The craters on St. Vincent rise higher than 1,000 meters above sea level, too high for trees. Dominica's volcanic past created sea cliffs, guarding secret valleys carved out of the rock beyond. It's this explosive history that makes these islands so lush. Volcanic soils are rich and fertile, fed by rainfall over the peaks. Today, these dense forests erupt with life. Many of these islands have their own unique species. Rare hummingbirds and parrots found nowhere else on Earth. Because this tropical paradise is so good for growing crops, it's good for people too. But islanders on places like Dominica and St. Lucia live in the shadow of the darker side of paradise. People literally live under a volcano, with constant reminders that beneath the surface, there's still plenty going on. St. Lucia's toxic sulfur springs have been hissing and bubbling for the past 4,000 years. This is Dominica's boiling lake. It's like a giant steaming saucepan. The threat of eruption to these volcanic islands is by no means a thing of the past. In 1995, the nearby island of Montserrat exploded. It was the first of many eruptions spanning several years. In some, clouds of superheated ash called pyroclastic flows roared down the mountain sides at nearly 70 miles per hour, incinerating everything in their path. The pyroclastic flows didn't stop when they hit the shore. They carried on hundreds of meters out to sea. Another huge eruption, an ash column rose more than 10 miles into the air.
These areas are extremely dangerous.
Montserrat's residents could only look on as their island went up in smoke.
This followed a major ash fall which covered Plymouth and the immediate surrounding areas.
As the sun was blotted out, tons of hot ash and rock rained down. It was a race against time to get out of the way. All this left parts of the island engulfed in mud and ash up to 10 meters deep. 19 people had lost their lives. Plymouth, the island capital, was once home to 3,000 people. Today, it's a ghost town. Half of Montserrat is now an exclusion zone, and eruptions continue. The last big blast was in 2006. Volcanic mountains don't just dominate life on the islands, but also in the surrounding seas. The coastline of Dominica plunges steeply down to the seabed, more than 1,000 meters below. These deep, sheltered waters attract one of the world's great hunters, the sperm whale. The deep waters are home to their favorite food, large squid. Sperm whales dive deeper than any other whale, descending more than 1,000 meters to find their prey. Adult males roam every ocean of the world. The females stick closer to their breeding grounds with their youngsters and newborn calves. These family groups are extremely tactile, with strong social bonds. Also use unique clicking patterns called codas to communicate. This group of sperm whales living so close to Dominica gives scientists a rare opportunity to study their complex lives. Exactly what they're saying, though, is still a mystery. Most of the volcanic islands in the Caribbean are relatively small, but others have quite different origins, and they're much larger. The biggest of them all is nearly 800 miles long, with a big atmosphere to match. Cuba. Old Havana, salsa and cigar capital of the world. Vibrant culture and music are famous worldwide. There's another side to Cuba, though. The limestone sculptures of its countryside. Beneath the limestone, Cuba is honeycombed by thousands of caves, more per mile than in any other country on Earth. Limestone dissolves in rainwater, and thousands of years of tropical downpours have created works of art. This gallery was carved by ancient rivers. And these calcium formations, helictites, have developed since the caves dried out. Geological formations are not the only spectacle down here. Bats. More than a million living in a single cave. They crowd together to keep warm and conserve energy, so they need less food to survive. Cuba is the Caribbean's bat capital, with 27 different kinds. Their body heat can tip the temperature to more than 40 degrees Celsius. So these are known as hot caves. Each evening they head out insect hunting. There are so many, it takes hours for them all to leave, creating a window of opportunity for other cave dwellers. Cave boas lurk in the darkness, trying to intercept the evening exodus. But even with such numbers, it's not easy plucking food out of thin air. The boa doesn't have echolocation like the bats, but it has thermal sensors on its face that detect body heat. Another near miss. But with hundreds of thousands of bats flying by every night, not all will make it out alive. Once wrapped in the boa's coils, there's no escape. One lucky strike will keep the snake going for several days. Cuba's caves are home to a much rarer mammal than the bat, the hutia, a rodent the size of a small dog. Hutias are found only in the Caribbean, and Cuba is their stronghold. They're nimble climbers and have long whiskers to help them feel their way around the limestone alleys in the dark. Hold up below ground, hutia avoid the heat of the day. But as the temperature drops, they emerge into the late afternoon sun. Even in the open, though, these shy creatures are not easy to spot. This is the first time anyone has filmed them in the wild. This sharp, rocky terrain is far from a Caribbean paradise, but these tough little rodents make themselves at home. They communicate with their family groups with high-pitched squeaks at the limit of what humans can hear. How do they survive on this bare limestone rock? The Hutia's secret is a three-chambered stomach, which allows it to extract enough nutrition and water from even the driest, most toxic plants. But it's no picnic on this Caribbean coast. There's yet another creature that roams Cuba's underworld. It emerges mostly at night and stays close to its hole. But once a year, triggered by rain, the females all emerge en masse. Female red crabs march together in one of the largest mass migrations in the world. This marathon can cover up to 6 miles and take days, especially if they take a wrong turn. So where are they going? Heading for the Caribbean Sea with one purpose in mind. These may be air-breathing land crabs, but they still need water for one thing: to breed. Each crab is carrying a pouch of precious eggs, and now she has to cast them adrift without letting herself be swept away. Once the eggs hit water, they hatch into tiny larvae, and in about a month's time, they'll climb back ashore to start their life on land. From the secret subterranean world of Cuba's limestone, to the great volcanic peaks, the low-lying sandy keys, the Caribbean has been shaped by a whole range of geological events, creating the great variety of islands that are here today. Just the geology that creates such a variety of islands. It's climate too. At the Caribbean's southernmost extreme, the climate has created an extreme environment. Less than 60 miles off the coast of South America are Aruba, Bonaire, and Curaçao, the ABC Islands. A world away away from lush volcanic slopes, these are the desert islands of the Caribbean. With no mountains and their southerly position, they get very little rain. And they are also exposed to strong, dry trade winds blowing across the Caribbean Sea. The wind is so strong here that trees like these divvies all tilt one way. Candelabra cacti deal with lack of water by storing it in their stems, while Turk's head cacti have roots several meters long. Turk's head fruit is a real treasure for a blue whiptail lizard. It's first come, first served. Tempers can get spiky when there's not enough to go around. All kinds of birds rely on fruiting cacti too. Orioles. But they've got competition. These yellow-shouldered parrots live only on the ABC Islands. Mockingbirds are also fruit lovers. The cactus fruit contains some moisture, but a proper drink is hard to find. So a freshwater spring is like a gold mine. Common ground doves flock to quench their thirst. And it's the only place a green iguana can cool off. Dry heat creates an island speciality. Salt pans. Heat evaporates off the water, leaving salt crystals. More than 400,000 tons each year. Evaporating sea salt here for more than 500 years. White gold that first attracted Dutch settlers. These tiny huts were used to shelter slaves who mined the salt. Can any wildlife exist in this harsh environment? Brine shrimps can thrive in water 9 times saltier than the sea. Along with brine flies, they provide food for the real treasures of this alien landscape. West Indian flamingos. Each year, around 20,000 flamingos fly in from South America to these remote salt ponds to feed and breed. The lack of both people and predators makes it a good place for raising chicks. It can take several days to build a nest from this hard, salty mud. Takes constant care to stop their single egg from roaming off. Once the chicks hatch, they feed on a rich, brine shrimp soup regurgitated by their parents. At around a month old, the chicks begin to strut their stuff together in a creche. In another few weeks, they'll be old enough to fly. They'll leave this salty nursery to feed in South America until they themselves return to breed. Sea Islands another special feature. So little rain means no rivers, so there's no silt running into the sea. This means they are surrounded by crystal clear waters and coral reefs. The tropical sun and warm clear waters provide ideal conditions for reefs to flourish. Fed by rich ocean currents flowing up from South America, Bonaire has the greatest variety of reef fish of any Caribbean island. The reefs of the Caribbean have over 800 species of fish, and at least 10 times that number of crustaceans and other invertebrates. Feature of the entire Caribbean, but there's one island that has hardly any at all. It's so close to South America that silt from the Orinoco River makes its waters too muddy for coral to grow. But its proximity to South America creates wild treasures of another kind. It's Trinidad. It may not have big reefs, but Trinidad's swamps and wetlands are a haven for some animals found on no other Caribbean island. These dazzling scarlet ibis are among the animals that find a rich supply of food in the nutritious mud. Even fish feed in the mud on tiny plants called diatoms. Half out of the water, they're exposed to predators like herons. But these fish have split vision, so they can see above and below the surface at the same time. They're known as four-eyed fish, but sometimes even four eyes aren't enough. Trinidad's real claim to fame is its much larger residence. Red howler monkeys don't live on any other Caribbean island. They howl to defend their territories. Red howlers are vegetarians, and with both forest and swamp on their doorstep, they can choose from a wide selection of fruits and leaves. Other monkeys have more sophisticated tastes. The same swamp is home to capuchins. They've learned to come down to swamp level at the right time to snaffle a delicacy. When water levels drop, freshwater conches are left high and dry, sitting targets for these grab and smash artists. Howlers and capuchins usually live only in South and Central America. And monkeys aren't the only mainlanders on Trinidad. This slow mover is a silky anteater. His giant claw and a gripping prehensile tail help keep his balance as he walks the mangrove tightropes of the swamp. So what makes Trinidad a haven for all these mainland castaways? The answer lies deep in the island's history. Until as recently as 2,000 years ago, it was part of South America. After the last ice age, rising sea levels gradually cut it off. So Trinidad is now a Caribbean island with a unique legacy of mainland life. Scarlet ibis are found around the deltas of the Amazon and Orinoco rivers. But up to 15,000 also live here in Trinidad's Caroni Swamp. Each evening, they return to roost. The ibis cram onto mangrove islets. Safety in numbers is the best way to make it through the night. Scarlet ibis are one of this island's most colorful spectacles. The other is a highlight of the entire Caribbean. Carnival. Carnival time, music, folklore, creatures mythical and real, all come together for the Caribbean's biggest party. Carnival embodies the true spirit of the Caribbean. A vibrant melting pot of life. The variety of wildlife comes from the variety of the islands themselves. The living treasures of the Caribbean. We leave the islands and dive into the crystal clear waters of the Caribbean Sea. explore their beautiful coral reefs and discover that they are home to some of the Caribbean's best.